Hello students, welcome to the sixth session of your grid course. And in the last session, there was something left which should have been edited and trimmed out, okay? And that's fine, okay? You should not concentrate on those things. You should concentrate on the experiment part of it, okay? And concepts part of it, okay? Sometimes they get missed while editing. Okay, sorry for that. Right, and in this session we are going to discuss something interesting again. What is that? You might have seen, if you put a pin, okay, a small pin into the water, the pin sinks, right? That's what we see. But huge ships which weigh a lot more than a pin actually floats on the surface of water, right? And that's little weird because ship is way more heavier than a pin, but even then it floats, but and the pin sinks. Why is it so? Let us understand the physics behind the floating of ships today. Okay, so it's about floating of ships. Okay, so let me give you the basic idea about forces. Okay, see, when you have a ship floating on the surface of water, okay, like this, obviously gravity will be pulling the ship downwards like this, right? Like this. And if gravity pulls the ship downwards, then it's obviously expected that ship should go into the water. Why isn't not going into the water? The reason is the force with which the gravity or the earth is pulling the ship downwards is equal to the force applied by water on the ship in the opposite direction. Okay, when you have two equal and opposite forces acting on a body, the body remains stationary. It doesn't move anywhere. Let me give you an example. See, this is the jack piece, right? If I push the jack piece like this, the jack piece starts to move in this direction. At the same time, if I push the jack piece like this, the jack piece starts to move in this direction, right? And if I push the jack piece from both the directions, okay, then the jack piece doesn't move anywhere. It stays in the place or in its original position here, right? In the same way, when the gravity pulls down the ships, at the same time, water pushes the ship upwards. So this force with which water or any other fluid is something which can flow, okay? Now let water is the fluid, nothing to worry, okay? The force with which water pushes an object upwards, okay, pushes an object upwards is called buoyant force, okay? Buoyant force. So this is basically from Archimedes' principle, okay? What is Archimedes' principle? Archimedes' principle says the force exerted by water on a body which is completely or partially immersed inside it is equal to the weight of the water displaced due to the immersion of the body. Nothing to worry about Archimedes' principle. Now we'll see how Archimedes' principle, buoyant force are all connected, okay? So now you got the basic idea that, okay, there is certain force which will push the ship upwards. That force is exerted by the water and the force is called buoyant force. That is why the ship floats, okay? Okay, the reason we got little clarity, that's fine. But why does the pin sink inside it? Because even the pin should also experience an upward force by the water, right? But this the pin, even though it is lot more lot less heavier compared to the ship, very lighter it is, okay, very small pin, but it sinks in the water. Doesn't the water exert buoyant force on the pin? If it exerts, how much force does it exert? All these factors decides whether a body is able to, will be able to float or will be able is going to sink. Okay, for this situation, the pin will obviously experience buoyant force. Okay, the pin will obviously experience buoyant force, the upward force by the water, but the force of gravity on the pin, the downward force, is greater than the buoyant force. Okay, that means the here at the same example. So the jack piece is held like this. Now I am applying the force from both the hands, but if the force by my right hand is greater than the force by my left hand, the jack piece starts to move in the direction of application of force by the right hand, right? In the same way, for the pin, the buoyant force is less than its weight or than the gravitational force on the pin. That is why the pin sinks. So now there comes again little confusion. Okay, now it is qualitatively understood. Okay, for the ship, buoyant force and gravity are equal. That is why it floats. For the pin, buoyant force is less than gravitational force. That is why it sinks. But now going into the quantitative approach, how much is the exact buoyant force experienced by ship, and how much is the exact buoyant force experienced by the pin? Okay, yeah, obviously we cannot take the ship and show you, but we have I have other experimental setup, and I'm going to show you the same kind of demonstration with other objects, and we will calculate the exact amount of buoyant force on different objects. Okay, let us do that now. Okay, so dear students, now I have two objects which are similar to the concept of pin and ship. Okay, this is one object with me which is similar to a pin, and this is going to be our ship now. Okay, so first let me show you the weight of these two. Okay, just observe, this is just 4.55 grams. Okay, can you see that? It is just 4.55 grams. Now let me weigh this. This is 35 gram. So this is heavier compared to this, right? That's true, we can see that. But if I put this into the water, what is expected to happen? What should happen? Whether it should sink or float? Observe. I just left it and it sunk. Right? Now this is just a 4.5 gram pin which just sunk. But now you have the ship of 45 gram. What should happen with this? Observe. It is floating. This is something which is heavier than the pin, but is floating. Okay, you might ask, you might say, sir, okay, fine, that's the buoyant force which is pushing it up. Okay, so now this is pulled down by the earth with more force than the pin, but at the same time water is applying buoyant force back on it, right? When the applied buoyant force and the weight becomes equal, the object floats. Okay, now you might think, okay, fine, it is just 35 gram with nothing inside it, yeah, it should float. But look at this, this is a weight of 50 gram. Okay, you can see this, close to 50 grams, and I am going to put this 50 gram weight into our ship. Okay, this is the load of the ship, and again I'll leave it inside it. What is expected to happen? Sink or float? Let us see. Okay, see what's happening. It is floating. Okay, so it is a total of 85 grams of weight which is still floating, right? So why is it happening? So why isn't so now it is the buoyant force which is responsible. We all got to know about it, but now the question that remains in mind is how much buoyant force exactly is acting on any body which is immersed inside water. Okay, now we'll get to know how much buoyant force acts on a body which is immersed inside water. What I have here is weights, which you all know, we have conducted experiments using this. Okay, what is the total weight of this? Each of them is 50 gram, right? How many of them are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 6 into 50, 300 grams of weight is there with me. And this is a spring balance, okay, where the weight is mentioned here, the mass of the object hung is mentioned here, and the force, the gravity, with the force with which the gravity pulls it down is also mentioned here directly. Okay, so here you have force, which is the weight of the object, okay, and here you have mass in the other side. Now as you can see, if I hang this to the spring, okay, like this, now look at the reading. As I say, it is close to 300 gram, right? Can you see that? This is the place. So it is close to 300 gram. At the same time, it is exerting a force of close to 2.8 newton, right? 2.8 or 2.9 newton of force. So 2.9 newton of force with which the earth is pulling it down, and 300 gram is the mass of the weights which I have hung here. Now what I'll do, I'll immerse this weight into the water and see what happens to the force and the mass. Okay, let me take the mass itself. Okay, because generally force is not given any on any spring balances, the regular spring balances, it's only the mass given. Okay, so mass of the object is 300 gram, let us not get confused. Okay, 300 gram mass. Now I'll immerse it. Okay, so when I immerse this weight into the water, the weight reduces. Can you see the weight? It has come down to 250 gram. Okay, just let me bring it close and show. See, now I have immersed it completely into the water. Okay, not completely, so that it touches the bottom. It is just in midway in water. Okay, now you see the reading. Okay, look at that. It is not 300 gram anymore, it is 250 gram, right? You see that? It is 250 gram is the new weight, new mass of it. Okay, fine. So now we are going to do few calculations based on it. Okay. Okay, there are few things which we observe from the experiment. First thing is, when the weight is outside, okay, when the weight, the set of weight is outside, how much did it show? The reading that was shown is mass, m, the mass that was shown was 300 gram, right? So it's not actually the mass which will vary. Mass of an object is always fixed. Okay, you go to outer space, you take that onto Earth, you take that onto Moon, wherever you go, mass is fixed. It doesn't change. Even here, mass is same, but the weight is changed here. Okay, so now the weight, or I can say the downward force, is mg. Okay, mass into acceleration due to gravity. You should remember this. Mass is 0.3 kg. Acceleration due to gravity, let me keep it close to 10. Okay, so it is 3 newton of force, close to 3 newton of force acting on it. Okay, now when I immersed this weight hanger into the water, it shows me 250 gram of reading, which means now the downward force, okay, now the downward force on this weight is not 250, is not 3 newton anymore. The new weight on this is 0.25 into 10, right? 0.25, because I need to keep it in kg, not in gram, that's why. Okay, 250 by 1000 is 0.25, that's why. So that is going to be 2.5 newton. So now what happened? Observe here. 3 newton of force is the original force on the weight set when it is in midair, only the air. But when I immerse the same weight hanger with weights into the water, it is now experiencing only 2.5 newton of force. What do you mean by that? That means this weight hanger is now experiencing an upward force of 0.5 newton, isn't it? Totally 3 newton. Now 0.5 newton is pushing it up when it is immersed inside the water. So how much is the force left? It is 2.5 newton of force which is left on it. That is why it shows 250 gram of mass. Okay, clear on this? So in midair, 3 newton of force. Inside water, 2.5 newton. Why? Because 0.25 newton upward force. What is that upward force? That upward force itself is buoyant force, right? So 0.5 newton of buoyant force is applied here. Now let me represent buoyant force using F subscript V. Okay, buoyant force for this situation is 0.5 newton. Okay, so now this is the practical observation. Right, now what does Archimedes principle say? Okay, Archimedes principle says that the buoyant force on any object immersed is equal to the weight of the water displaced. Okay, so now what is the weight of the water which is displaced here? Let us work on that and get the buoyant force. So the expression becomes, the net force is equal to, or the buoyant force is equal to, weight of the water displaced. Okay, which means when I immerse certain load into the water, certain water gets displaced or gets raised, right? That volume of water is equal to the volume of object that I put in, right? But it is about weight of the water, which means the buoyant force is always equal to mass of the displaced water. Okay, mdw, dw subscript, okay, mass of the displaced water into acceleration due to gravity g. Okay, what is mass of the displaced water? We should take the mass of the water out and get it. Okay, that's one way. So now according to this, buoyant force should be this much, but since I do not have the mass of the water got displaced, I'll go with the other approach. Okay, the other approach is mass of the water displaced is density of water into volume of water displaced, right? Density of water into volume of water displaced into acceleration due to gravity. This is the buoyant force. Okay, now what is the net force? Net force means the final force, which is 2.5 newton here. Okay, so net force is given by the weight of the object, okay, which is mg, this one, 3 Newton, okay, minus weight of the displaced water, okay, mass of water into acceleration due to gravity, mass of object immersed into acceleration due to gravity, downward force, this is upward force, this is buoyant force, this is gravitational force acting on you, okay. So now what is mass equal to? Mass of an object is density into volume, right? Because we define density as mass by volume. So here it is density into volume into acceleration due to gravity minus this is the buoyant force according to the Archimedes principle. So see, now when I immerse the object into the water, the volume of water increased is equal to the volume of object immersed, right? So it is the same volume, okay, it is the, this density is density of an object immersed, which I can call rho v, and this density is density of water because this is mass of water, but volume is same for both of them because the rise in volume of water is equal to the volume of immersed object into g. Now out of these two, you can observe V and G are common factors. So the net force or the total force acting on the body will be equal to density of object immersed minus density of water into volume displaced into acceleration due to gravity. This is the final expression for the total force acting on the body which is immersed inside the water completely or partially. So now when it comes to the floating mechanism that we saw when a cylindrical body is put into the water, okay, as we saw there, so there the object was solid, but even then it did not sink because there was air filled in the empty space of the object, right? So air's density should also be counted there. And at the same time, the cylindrical object, which acts as an example of ship, displaces more water outside compared to the water displaced by a small pin. Clear on that? So when it displaces more water outside, there the buoyant force is more for that particular case. When there is more buoyant force, the object floats. Since the pin that you put in can displace less water and hence less buoyant force, and hence it sinks. Okay, this expression is important. This is the experimental observation. Now let me go for the theoretical observation and show you that the net force is 2.5 Newton again, okay. Students, now what I have is the weight set, and now I'm going to immerse this weight set into the water, okay. And you can observe now the initial volume of water is close to 150 ml or 150 centimeter cube, right. Now you observe for the volume of water or the increase in volume of water, okay, from 150 to what volume does it go? So before that, you be sure that this is 150, this is 175, and this is 200 ml, okay. Just observe. So I have immersed it completely. I'm trying to push that completely because even the weight of this hanger the volume of the hanger will also affect it. It is also necessary for us, but since it's not going completely inside, it is close to 200 ml, okay. So 175 185 190, it is close to 200 ml because this part is left outside, okay. So even if that part also goes inside, the total volume will be 200 ml close, okay, close to 200 ml again, because this could not go in. So the initial volume is 150 centimeter cube or 150 ml and the final volume is 200 ml, and hence the increase in volume or the volume of displaced water is is 50 mL, and at the same time volume of this weight set is also 50 mL itself, because the volume of immersed object is equal to volume of water displaced. Clear? So one observation is the volume increase in volume, or the volume of displaced water is equal to 50 mL. Okay, now we shall go for arithmetical calculation and see or verify the Archimedes principle and the practical observation that we did with the spring balance. Right. As you just saw with the experimental observation, the volume of water got displaced is found to be the volume of water displaced and the object immersed, both of them included, is found to be close to, okay, close to 50 mL, right, which is 50 cm³. Okay, these conversions and all we will study in detail. Now when I convert the volume from centimeter cube to meter cube, that becomes 50 × 10⁻⁶ meter cube. Okay, nothing to worry about these conversions and all, they are all easy, we can discuss them in the coming classes. So now this is the volume of water displaced and the object immersed, and density of water is standard value. Okay, density of water is always 1000 kg/m³. Okay, so density of water is 1000 kg/m³. So what is the mass of water displaced there? So mass of water displaced is equal to density of water into volume of water. What is density of water? 1000 into, what is volume of water? 50 × 10⁻⁶. See, 1000 is 10⁻³. Okay, 10⁻⁶ + 3 is 10⁻⁻³, right? So it is 50 × 10⁻³, which is left. Now when I put 10⁻³, simplify that with this, so that becomes shifting 0, 1, 2, 3. Yeah, it is 50 cm³ of water displaced, so it is 0.05 kg of water displaced. Okay, this is the mass of the water displaced, right? This is the mass of displaced water according to the observation again. But from Archimedes principle, it says that the force, buoyant force, is equal to the weight of the water displaced, not mass, weight of the water displaced. So what is the weight of the water displaced? Weight of the water displaced is mass into acceleration due to gravity. Weight is always represented by capital W. Weight of the displaced water, okay, weight of the displaced water is equal to mass of the displaced water into acceleration due to gravity. Okay, same way as of this mg, okay, which is equal to 0.05 × 10, which is equal to 0.5 N. That's it. So now you can observe the buoyant force according to Archimedes principle is 0.5 N, and what we observe practically is also 0.5 N. And hence today we verified Archimedes principle and we just revealed the secret behind floating of heavy ships. Good. Thank you.